Right. So this morning that what we want to look at is this thing. Okay, and we consider it for lambda equals 0, and we show that phi of x, phi of 0, can be written as derivative logarithm of ZB, where ZB is the partition function with the source there. So when we consider this morning, we saw derivatives with respect. We wrote this as a scalar product between two vectors. So we wrote derivatives with respect to indices. If we consider this as functions, then we have to take the functional derivative. All right. Very good. So what happens? So let me first start by something that doesn't work. Okay, and then we'll see how to make it work. So, what happens when we have lambda different from zero? So, this average is now has to be taken with this function here, which is not Gaussian anymore. Okay, so we don't know how to do the integral, the functional integral. So what we have to do is the following. Integral define e to the minus, phi of x, phi of 0, e to the minus 1/2, integral dx, phi minus number squared plus minus squared phi minus integral dx lambda over 4 phi to the fourth, and then we have to divide by integral phi of this. Okay. So we can think of doing perturbation theory. Okay? So perturbation theory, the idea is that we write this exponential as the product of two exponentials, and we expand this in powers of lambda. We also have to expand this in powers of lambda. Okay, so we have to do something like this. Phi of x, phi of 0, and then we expand this exponential. Let's say to first order, 1 minus lambda over 4, integral, let me write it, dy, phi of y to the fourth, okay, plus blah, 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 e to the minus 1/2 integral dx, phi minus delta plus mu squared times phi, divided by the same thing, without this. Let's look at the numerator. First. So we expand the numerator and denominators in powers of lambda. Okay? So in the numerator we have average. Now the average can be taken with. Now the idea is the following. We are taking the average of this object here with this measure. This measure is Gaussian. So we can use Big's theorem to write expectation values of powers of phi. So we have phi x, phi 0, okay? And then we have minus lambda over 4 integral dy average phi x, phi 0, phi to the fourth y. Okay, and here we have average 1 minus lambda over 4 average of phi 4 y. Average of 1 is 1. Divide both terms by the zero, so this is really an average. Otherwise, average of one would be ZZ. Okay, so the idea is about, so this thing here is what we computed, is what we computed this morning, right? So this will be, so let me write this, yes. So let me, so to first order in lambda, we are working first order in lambda, we have average 5x, phi of 0, minus lambda over 4, average of phi integral in dy, average phi of x, phi of 0, phi 4, y. Plus, actually, 1 times 1 plus lambda over 4 phi, well, actually, let's leave it like this. So let's compute for the moment the numerator, okay? So this, compute the numerator for the moment. So this is C0 of x, the correlation function for without lambda. And then we have this thing here. So how do we do this? So we have now 6 points, 6 values of phi. So we have phi at, let's write this as, so phi fourth y, let's write it as phi y1, phi y2, phi y3, phi y4. And then we send y1, y2, y3, and y4 to the same point. Okay, this is called point splitting. So we have x, 0, and we have 4 other points. 1, 2, 3, 4. And now what we have to do is we have to pair. Okay, as I said in Big's theorem, the average of products of phi's is just the product of contractions. Okay? So the average of phi x, phi 0, phi y 1, phi y 4, I have to do contractions. So the first contraction will be, the first class of contraction is when phi x, phi 0 is contracted, and I get the C0 of x. And then I have to do the contractions of this part here. Okay? So and the contractions of this part here will be average of phi y1, phi y4.
How many terms there are in these things? We said it this morning. There are three possible terms. Okay? One with two, three with four. One with three, two with four. One with four, and two with three. But since we have to send all the points to the same point, these three terms will be equal. Okay? So this will be three times average of phi y to the 4. Average of phi y squared. And then there are other terms, okay? The other terms come when we contrast x with one of these, and y has to be contrasted with the other ones. Also, these ones will be equal, right? Because then all these points are being. But this time we will have phi of x, phi of 0, phi of y, and then we have phi of 0, phi cube of y, which would be three times this thing here. Okay. So, you see, the only thing that we have to phi of y squared. Okay, this one here is c phi x phi 0, and then the contraction of these four ones here, which are three terms in which we have two times phi of y squared average. So phi of y squared average squared times 3. So you see here, okay, so we have the first term there is lambda over 4 c0 of x integral dy of average of phi to the 4 y. Okay? This term here. And then there is another term. There is this term, which is minus lambda over 4 integral dy c0 of x minus y c0 of 0 minus y and then c0 of y minus y. So this is exactly this thing here. Okay. You see, this is exactly this. So we have c0 of x, which multiplies 1 minus lambda 4 average integral dy. Integral dy of phi to the 4 of y. Divided by 1 minus lambda over 4 integral dy average phi to the 4 to y. And then there is another term, which is minus, and this is at first order in lambda, so we don't care about this object in the denominator, minus lambda over 4 integral dy c0 of x minus y c0 of 0 minus y c0 of y minus y. Okay, so this drops out, and this is the correction. Now let's look at this correction.
Let me write a diagram. From 0, I go to y. From y, I go to y. And from y, I go to x. Okay? So,
this is a diagram, and if I, which corresponds to the following. So I have to, so the contribution is minus lambda divided by 4 integrand dy of this thing here. So this diagram corresponds to the following number, lambda over 4 integrand dy c of y minus 0, 0 minus 1, doesn't really matter, y minus 0, c of y minus y, so c0 of x minus y. Okay, so my particle, quote unquote, goes from 0 to y, then makes a loop at y, comes back at y, and then goes from y to x. Okay, so it's just this contribution here. Okay, so this contribution here is phi of x, phi of y, which we said it's taking the average with the Gaussian integral, therefore it's the inverse of this operator here between x and y. Then 0 and y, again the average with the Gaussian integral, so it's 1 over the operator, the inverse operator between 0 and y, and then the average of phi y. So you can think of this as a process. This is a Feynman diagram. You can think of this as a process going from 0 to y, making a loop and coming back at y, okay, and then going from y to x. So I want to go from 0 to x. I have, so the two contributions that I have are these ones. The first one we said is this, 0 to x directly, which is just c0 of x minus 0. And then the second one is this thing. Okay? Now, this is all fine and good. So this is perturbation theory. We can keep doing, I mean, there are integrals, for example, the Feynman integrals are very useful because, for example, at lambda square, order lambda square, you can already recognize what are the other diagrams. Okay, there's a diagram which is essentially the square of this one, okay, in which I go from 0 to y1, then I go from y1 back to y1, then I go to y2, then back to y2, okay, and then finally go to x. There is a new diagram. This is essentially the square of this thing. So if I integrate over x, I take the square, I integrate over x, I get this. There is another diagram, which is like this. Okay, I go from 0 to y1. Then from y1 to y2, then back to y1, then back to y2, and then finally go to x. So it's very interesting because you can, if you write a diagram like this, it's very easy to write down the integral. This integral will be integrand dy1 dy2, okay, of c0 of y1 minus 0, c0 of y2 minus y1, 2 and 3 times cube, because it's even function of y1 minus y2, and then finally c0 of x minus y2. Okay? So, good. Now, in principle, one can go on forever, right? Writing diagram after diagram. However, this is a little problem. The problem is this. Okay. Let's write the integral representation of this object. And let's see what's the problem. What is the problem? What do you think is the problem? Let's write this integral here. It's the integral in ddk. So c0 of y minus y, the integral in ddk divided by 2 pi to the d, e to the I k y minus y, so 0, so this is 1, okay, divided by k squared plus mu squared. So what's wrong with this integral? If d is larger or equal than 2, this integral is divergent. Okay? So, this goes like, let's suppose we integrate up to a given cutoff, lambda. This integral goes like the cutoff to the d minus 2. So, if you are interested in ferromagnets in 3 dimensions, for example, but even 2 dimensions, this will diverge logarithmically. In 2 dimensions. And we have a problem, because we said that this was a small perturbation, and we did perturbation theory because lambda was small. But we find that this thing is actually, it's actually infinite. Okay? If we take the cutoff going to infinity. Or anyway, it's large, it's going to be large, because we said that capital lambda is the inverse of the lattice spacing. And we want to take the limit in which lattice spacing goes to zero. So it's a problem. Okay. Now, in particle physics, this is solved. In particle physics, you really want to take the limit of the cutoff that goes to infinity, okay? Because you know, we don't see any lattice structure in space-time, so you want to send lambda to infinity and see what you get. And then what do we have to do? Well, I mean, intuitively, if this is infinity, somehow you need to change this lambda, okay, send it to zero somehow, okay, to do something more smart. Send it to zero, lambda, such a way to compensate. In statistical physics, we are privileged from another point of view, okay? The point of view is that really the cutoff is not infinite. So this is an effective description of our system. We are not saying that this is a microscopic description. We know what is the microscopic description. It's electrons with spins interacting and stuff, right? So, what we need to do is to understand to understand in which sense our description is an effective description, and understand how different effective descriptions are related to each other. Okay? Let me be more specific about this. Okay, so, good. So let's consider what we are doing, okay? So we are doing
We have a lattice here. And we say that this lattice on which our spins live, there's a lattice spacing A.
But there is also a correlation length,
psi, which is many, many lattice spaces. And this is exactly, this is actually what enters the NAB, the correlation function. It's the correlation length. The correlation length depends on many things. The temperature, for example, of our system. And we know that when the temperature goes to critical temperature, there is a phase transition, and correlation length will diverge. And the susceptibility will diverge with it. So, if we have two different temperatures of our system, effectively, there will be just the same model described with a different different correlation. The underlying lattice is not important. But then, there must be a way of changing the lattice constant to match the two things. So there must be a way to go from A to BA such that the correlation length psi goes into some B. Here I will be generic. Usually you would put something like B minus 1 A, okay? B. But we are going to see that we need to put this as a generic number here. So there must be some transformation that we can make. It's in order to make a similarity between at the statistical level between systems with a given lattice spacing and a given temperature, and system with another lattice spacing and another temperature. Okay? So, in a statistical sense, this is what we need to do. But changing the lattice spacing by B. So we need to change. So the idea is the following: we need to change the lattice spacing. We need to change also the parameter. If we change at the same time the parameters of our free energy and the lattice spacing, we should obtain the same result. Okay? If they change together in a specific way, which the mathematics has tell us what it is, okay, then we are still describing the same physics. Okay. So changing the lattice spacing is like changing the cutoff. So the cutoff is 1 over A. So lambda gets reduced. So there must be a way that we can integrate out some modes at high frequency to obtain the same model on low frequency modes. This is the idea of the renormalization group. So, what we need to do is to take our, phi of x, remember, phi of x was, you know, we can expand it into plane waves. This is very useful because this diagonalized the quadratic part of the free energy. And the idea is that we can write this sum over k between lambda over, now let's take a b larger than 1, okay? K between lambda and lambda over B of e to the I kx
by k, and then the other ones between 0 and lambda over b. When we do the path integral, we do the path, if we are interested in distances which are much larger, so x minus 0 is much larger than 1 over lambda over b, then in this integral, what we need to do is to do the integral over the high frequency mode first. There will be no divergence now, okay? And then we are left with an effective model on which we can compute, which contains only the low frequency modes, on which we can compute the correlation function. The correlation function is going to be the same. Okay, this is the idea behind the randomization group. So if we want to do the calculations have to be done
In this case, we're doing the normalization in the momentum space, right?
Yeah, this is momentum space normalization. Yeah, I mean, the idea, the computation are different, but the idea can be carried also in real space. In real space, what we'll do, for example, if b is equal to 2, what we do is we take our model and we integrate every second lattice space. If we are computing correlation function at distance 100, I mean, we can do this many times. Okay, log base 2 of 100 before we actually have to integrate over the last two points. The results are the same. So the real space normalization group was worked up by Kadanov and Migdal.
This is in the reciprocal space, right?
And the momentum space normalization group was the work of Kenneth Wilson, for which he got the Nobel Prize. Oh, sorry, I forgot E to the IK. Okay, so I split the phi of x into two functions, phi larger of x, high frequency, and so it's like having a function which does like this, right? And I split it into some kind of moving average plus fluctuations. Okay, so this function is this plus this. And since I have to integrate over functions, what I want to do is I want to integrate over this noise, quote unquote, term first to see what's the effective model for the low wavelength. Okay? All right. Now, let me give you a sketch of the calculations. And this way of doing things, you don't encounter any divergence. You keep your cutoff, you reduce your cutoff, you rescale again your variables, and you're going to see how the parameters change under this rescaling. By the way, there is a way of thinking of thinking to even high energy physics in this sense. Every model in high energy physics is not really fundamental. It's just an effective model. Okay. And you know, they must come from a more fundamental model, and even that probably comes from an even more fundamental model. It's not that since we don't know the fundamental model, we cannot do the calculations. For example, calculations in QED can be done without knowing what's the grand unified theory that unifies gravity with You know, we can do, because we have an effective model, we can think of having integrated out those very high energy modes and having been left with some. Okay, so for example, when we have this integral, the, let's say, four dimensions, so let's work around four dimensions, but does it really matter? No, it doesn't matter. Let's work in the dimension. Dx of phi of x squared to the fourth, sorry. Then this will be dx phi less plus phi larger to the fourth. Okay? So we will have dx phi less to the fourth plus 3 times dx phi less cube phi larger plus 3 times dx phi larger cube less plus 6, what's the, is it 6? Yeah, I think it's 6. Okay, so when we integrate, so what we want to do is we want to integrate out this variable here. And we are going to be left with the functional of this variable here. But now our theory doesn't have the cutoff lambda anymore, it has the cutoff lambda over b. Of course, this integrating out cannot be done exactly, but has to be done in perturbation theory. But now, this time, perturbation theory will not have divergences. Okay. So, the quadratic part is even easier, because the quadratic part, we say, it's diagonal in these terms, right? So, when we have integration of dx of phi less plus phi larger squared, actually, let's do the phi larger minus nabla plus mu squared. Less by larger. This will not have of diagonal terms, okay? Because these are decomposed in the subspace which is invariant, left invariant by this operator. So if you want, this will be sum over k of 1/2. So k less than between lambda and lambda over b. Of 1/2 of k squared plus mu squared 5k squared plus some k less than lambda over b of the same thing. So this is lambda larger, this is So the quadratic part, at the quadratic part they are uncoupled. It's the quartic part that couples them. So when we now take the expectation value, we do the expansion in lambda, in small lambda, the interaction, and we take the expectation value. Now at this point, this term here and this term here will be zero, because the average of phi less is equal to the average of phi larger is equal to zero. Okay. This one will not be zero, but we can compute it easily. And this one will be something, but we, since we are only integrating between capital K, capital lambda, and capital lambda over B, will be finite. Okay? So, now we have the same kind of diagrams as before, only that this time, when we integrate, so we only are interested in correlation function between phi less and phi less, the low energy modes, and this loop is only on phi larger, okay? So here now we have things like minus lambda over 4, integral k over 2 pi to the d of 1, the integral is between lambda over b and lambda, 1 over k squared plus mu squared. And then we have phi less of x. Okay, so the point, the loop, which starts at y and comes back at y, is this one, but the integral is not over all the k's, but k's between lambda over b. So to be quick, so what we, okay, so we can do these calculations here. I want you to just, I want just to give you an idea of this thing. I mean, you don't, as I said, this is a bit, little bit too advanced for the exam, but I wanted to show you anyway what it means, in case some of you is actually interested in doing this. So what it means is that now, after we have integrated we have this equality, okay? And we have a new free energy, F prime, and the new free energy is at lowest order the same as the old free energy with different parameters, okay? So mu square, mu prime square will be equal to mu square plus lambda over 4 pi to the d half, 1 over gamma of d half, 1 minus b, 2 minus d, d minus 2, capital lambda, d minus 2. Notice that if b is equal to 1, we get 0. Clearly, because we are not integrating out anything. Right? Lambda, between lambda and lambda. And the other parameter that changes is lambda, right? So we have a lambda prime now. Lambda prime is equal to lambda minus minus 3 lambda square divided by 4 pi. This all comes from these integrals here, these spherical integrals. 4 pi d half gamma d half 1 minus b 4 minus d divided by d minus 4 lambda d minus 4. Okay, so for D between 2 and 4, so this is how the new parameters of the free energy are related to the old parameters of the free energy in perturbation theory for small lambda. Okay, if you put lambda equals 0, you see that this is a fixed point. If lambda equals 0, the change in mu is 0, the change in lambda is 0. So, lambda is equal 0 is a fixed point. Since for lambda equals 0, the integral is Gaussian, it's called the Gaussian fixed point. And it describes a region far away from the critical point, either in the ferromagnet or in the paramagnet, but far away from the critical point. Actually, let's do this one. Let's put mu here so that this entire line is a fixed point. Okay, if you are on this line for lambda equals 0, you can only move. And if you look at this, if the dimension is larger than 2, dimension larger than 2, remember b is larger than 1, so this is 1 minus 1 over b to some power, so it's positive, divided by positive, so the mass increases. Okay, very good. Now, if we want to compare actually to the same, so we remember we have rescaled this, right? So what we have to do is now, if you want to compare the two things, we have to rescale the lattice spacing. And this gives to this an extra, it's not that there is really important at this level of the discussion, this is a b squared here, because this is the engineering dimension of mu, and this gives it's not really important. Okay. Now, if we fix mu equal to 0, this is really, if we take mu small, then not exactly equal to 0, because we have infrared divergences as well. So if you look at this, for the same reasoning, this thing here is negative, okay? So if d is between 2 and 4, this is positive, but there is a minus sign here. So in doing this
transformation, our parameters flow in this direction.
This is the only thing we can say at the moment. So if we do, if we are not very close, if we are not very close to the, if we are not very close to the, another critical point, which is not the Gaussian fixed point, we flow towards the Gaussian fixed point, and then go fast away from it. The Gaussian fixed point is a subtle point of this transformation. Okay. If we do things properly, not at this level of calculation, but we do, you know, a little bit more calculation, we find that there is another fixed point here, which is unstable. Okay. And this fixed point here describes the phase transition. The mass is equal to zero, meaning that the correlation length is infinite at this fixed point. So the correlation length is infinite, but there are other scaling quantities. Quantities scale with certain critical exponents. Okay, so this is everything that I wanted to tell you about this. It's just an introduction. It's not just to stimulate your interest in this topic, which is, as I say, too advanced for this class, but I wanted to dedicate one lecture to it because I think it's actually a beautiful way to think about statistical physics, which has been very fruitful and will be fruitful in the future as well. Okay. Do you have any questions? Stop here.